You're coming back to Los Angeles after being in Louisiana. And
summer of 65.
Summer of 65. And so you come back to L.A., and what do you find that's going on here?
Well, 2 weeks after we came back, Watts arrived. And we weren't at all surprised because before we'd gone south, we had been active in Corps, doing surveys and doing a lot of work in the black community. And we thought the biggest problems were segregated schools. We had our conception of what was bothering the black community, but we went in and did interviews and talked and canvassed, and we found more than black schools, what people talked about in the black community were the police. We were surprised, we didn't prompt that. We just listened to what they had to say. In fact, the overwhelming complaint was the behavior of the police in the black community. It's not an unfamiliar refrain. And so early that year, Corps and several other civil rights organizations had organized meetings to talk to the black city councilman, for the city councilman, the city council. And Barbara went with a small representative group of people from the civil rights group and talked to the mayor, Mayor Yorty.
Right.
Mayor Yorty.
We actually have some of that here.
And saying, the community is very upset and it's dangerous and you should be paying attention. And they were totally dismissive of that information. So when we came back, it just seemed like, it was kind of a sad righteousness, like we told them it was going to happen.
Right, you can feel that.
And CORE never was the same again in Los Angeles. Because what you've seen was the CORE had not been able, powerful or persuasive enough, to help the black community in this respect. We had no leverage on a white city organization, the city government, and the basically white police force to protect the black community. Civil rights groups just did not have any leverage.
So this is from the Mayor Yorty's.
And that's about poverty at that time. But if it wasn't about poverty, that's a specific, one of the many specific demonstrations over one or another unique situation. But we did the same thing about police brutality was something we found was not something that we could be persuasive about. We didn't have the votes, because actually, as Barbara said, one of the remarks that Yorty or one of his associates said, how many votes do you have? And they said, we've done the count. The black community doesn't vote enough to be persuasive. And so you may tell us this is true, but in a sense, they didn't say so what, but basically it was like so what. So we come back and Watts occurs, which, suddenly the city is burning and the National Guard is guarding the street. I don't know how many people died during the Watts uprising. And it wasn't really an uprising. It was uprising in a sense, because there was all this anger and rage that found it rose up and manifested.
Bubbled over.
But it wasn't controlled. It wasn't organized. Uprising almost tends to make you think of a political uprising, but it was an uprising of rage, a bursting force is probably better.
Did you take a lot of shots at, were you involved with that?
No.
Documenting that?
No. We just come back from a couple of months in the South and we were exhausted. Actually, when we left and came back from the South, we were like fleeing. We just couldn't take it anymore.
And CORE wasn't working because of its approach to nonviolence?
It was very clear that CORE had not been effective in alleviate any of the rage that led to the Watts uprising. We had pinpointed it, we publicized it, we'd gone to the city government with no effect. And Barbara and I were both like affected by having been in the South and very disillusioned once we got back to Los Angeles as to how what had been wonderful there didn't exist in Los Angeles, and we had no answers. There was nothing we could do, except gradually, month by month, different things did start developing. There was a community watch program where people traveled the black community with cameras to record if they saw something happening, to record police behavior. In fact, I designed some posters about that, how to protect your own community. And we found the police did not like being photographed. If there was a traffic stop or any kind of a stop, it was dangerous to be part of the community watch program, to be there and take pictures. Often, the police would just run away, but half the time they wouldn't, and they'd give you a really bad time. So I mean, we found some tactics, but they didn't basically affect the basic nature of city government. And that still exists today. That has not been, controlling the police has never been successful.
And I see just from going through these boxes, you continued to cover a lot of demonstrations that were in the LA area.
Yes, and we were still active in CORE. And we were also meeting a lot of different people who were suggesting other approaches. There were some crazy people who wanted to throw bombs. I don't know, it's very satisfying. I'm sure it really would be nice to do something effective like that.
So we were looking at some of these, and this was Bunchy Carter's funeral. And can you just tell us a little bit of information, like who they were, and they were shot by on the UCLA campus, and then during the funeral there was...
This had to be dated to the point a couple of years after the Black Panther Party had been organized.
The Black Panther Party.
Black Panther Party had been organized in the Bay Area. And Bobby Seale, and they actually marched on the California State Legislature with guns, but in a way that apparently didn't break any laws, but it was saying the black community needs to arm itself. See, they were dealing with the same problem that we civil rights groups had not been able to deal with, because nonviolent demonstrating did not move the city government to do anything to restrain the police. So they created an organization basically around that issue, police brutality, and it mirrored what had happened in the South. The black community arms it still. And the black community always had a lot of weapons. It just made part of their culture. And here in Los Angeles, after a couple of years, you had a very strong organization that was doing political education among black high school students, had a free breakfast for children. Kids who went to the schools without any warm breakfast, let alone any breakfast at all. And two of the top leaders of the Black Panther Party were murdered on the campus of UCLA by a rival black organization, which was police funded, Ron Karenga's group. And these two, John Huggins and Bunchy Carter, were both shot to death at the Black Student Union at UCLA. And this pile of newspapers that I found, these folders I found within the last week, had the headlines, and when the two Panther leaders were murdered at UCLA, the police arrested about 20 people. They were all Black Panthers. They were like all the associates of the two, and they raided the homes and offices of the organization of the two murdered men. They didn't arrest Karenga or anything. Didn't raid his office.
Right, and they used it as an opportunity to further kind of disseminate.
And have a newspaper, and they listed the names of the people, and half of the names I recognize. So these pictures you pulled out.
There was
a week or so later, there was the funeral of Bunchy Carter at a big black church downtown, and it drew an enormous outpouring of black community people. And I didn't know what was happening, but someone said, I was at the church, and they said, they're arresting everybody who's trying to come to the church. So I got in my car and started driving around, and the police, for a perimeter of two or three, five blocks, were stopping all cars that had black men in them, stopping them and arresting everybody, every black man, to keep them from going to the funeral. And I just happened, not knowing, just to get these pictures. There are all these guys that either in handcuffs, policemen with drawn revolvers.
This guy's like an undercover.
No, he just has a raincoat on.
Oh.
but they were kind of weird, sort of like, you know. And they were afraid of something. But they're having a funeral, a very respectful funeral, but a very militant funeral, as it was a demonstration of the young Panthers with their raised fists. And then did a whole series of photographs of the
funeral.
So,
do you know any of these people that are in the picture?
Charles Gary is the San Francisco Bay Area attorney for the Panthers, and that's Eldridge Cleaver's wife, Catherine Cleaver. That's Bobby Seale. And there's that nervous policeman with a gun in his hand. Well, yes, we were. But this was an occasion of mourning. This was an occasion of taking somebody to the grave. And a traditional black funeral is very emotional. You view the body, you have nurses usually it's this tradition for some of the older women to scream and collapse and faint while working it out. And you notice when you watch news from all around the world, what a tradition that is in so many different cultures.
That's right.
For the women to be able to emotionally collapse and release their grief.
And then I pulled some of these too. This is when James Baldwin.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, he toured for CORE, fundraising, and he spoke at the black churches and at garden parties.
Was that kind of a powerful moment in terms of bringing people together?
It was incredible. Yes. At that point, we suddenly got phone calls from a number of people we knew in the entertainment industry. He said, can you get us tickets to the
beach? Well, it looks kind of like a fashionable event.
This was a garden party.
Yeah.
Relatively charming. But then there was the big thing at one of the big churches, and all the Hollywood agents, not all, several calls, says, can you get us tickets to hear James Baldwin speak?
It's like the hot ticket. All right, let's go back and look through. You can put the camera on pause just for a second so that I can kind of recoup you.
And this really.
So what? That's from.
This is, I guess, probably 1964. We got a call that there's a lynching going on the SC campus, and this is a fraternity.
On which campus?
SC, okay. USC.
Okay.
And apparently this was a tradition. I got one over there right away. This fraternity, this USC fraternity, believed in celebrating the Old South, the Confederacy, and every year they had a mock lynching, which was not for them lynching a black person. It was lynching the U.S. government. But they all wore.
But you can see they have a Confederate flag.
Confederate flag, and they have a body hanging from a rope, and one of their black employees, a busboy, or standing by watching the lynching.
Yeah, I couldn't.
Until
you pointed, I was wondering, what.
But I mean, it's not. Yeah, and I got. But we and somebody it just we called the campus and said, this is objectionable, because the civil rights movement. That's interesting because that sort of kind of. These are demonstrations where, this was Southwest Realty Board, because the organized realty organization definitely believed in segregated housing. I mean, they would steer people to the right housing project. If you were black or Asian or Latino, they wouldn't send you to a white new project opening up. They'd send you to your appropriate one. And so we demonstrated against the Real Estate Association. And they're blocking a driveway at the end of a meeting.
Okay, so this is like more of a lie-in rather than somebody who's lying there injured.
That's right. That's somebody. Yes.
Okay. I'm going to just put these back away.
These are not in order of the demonstrations.
No, but they're in order of however they're in the particular.
But see, here were the four people blocking a car and coming out of the parking lot. I pulled it out of somewhere, so you should put it there. And these are all completely unrelated. And there's a core demonstrator who'd been beaten up at a demonstration. In early days, the demonstrations against the Board of Education over segregated schools, the police were very polite. They took the demonstrators away on stretchers. You know, they didn't beat them, they didn't grab them, didn't drag them. They were being very proper. And we watched over the, as time passed, how the orders changed. Like, you know, you can be rough now.
Hmm.
And then when the Panthers came along, you could be beaten badly. In fact, we noticed in some demonstrations, clearly, there was a sex-linked rule that men, the demonstrators got beaten on the head, and women demonstrators got beaten on the butt. You know, clearly the police could tell what they liked doing.
That's right.
It was really strange.
Now, who was this woman? Because I noticed there were several photos.
She was a white fundraiser.
Because she has her own folder that you...
She turned out not to be important. And these are sort of... Did you realize in Los Angeles, downtown, there was a newsreel theater?
Is that on Broadway?
I don't remember. But all you could go in and watch nothing but newsreels.
That's great. Still in the 60s, though?
Yes, uh-huh. These were demonstrators who had gone on a fast at the Board of Education. And they did desegregate the schools somewhat. And this was a big march in San Francisco as James Park, head of CORE. And here's John Lewis, just on that. It's fascinating. Who's here now, who's a congressman.
Mm.
And this was at the SC fraternity.
There's their chef.
The two black employees on the roof with the big, mm-hmm. and the slogan of the fraternity, "We secede," and the big Confederate flag, and then of course the body hanging, the lynching going on. And there were some like local press. There was like a press photographer, probably from the LA Times or something. They didn't cover it. We gave it a lot of publicity. They didn't run the story.
They ended up not running the story?
Ninth day, 213 hours fasting. That was pretty good. And there was a big, good demonstration with Rita Moreno and Merv Diamond,
wow.
Anthony Francios was in this demonstration also. We had a lot of, these are good people, pillars of the society. Not many ghetto, you can see everybody's dressed up. there were two types of demonstrations, those and then there were the CORE demonstrators. There's Barbara, there's the Episcopal priest, and Mark Arcelor, who was a very successful black architect, and Bruce Boyd, who was a poet. This was like the cross-section of people in...
Here's all the gum shoes.
Yeah. And here are people practicing for a chain in order to keep from a sit-in being broken up. If you change yourself together, it took a lot longer until you got better press and more people got to see what was happening. They were rehearsing. Getting a little rough on talking more than usual.
And here's the Century City demonstration. And you can see this is where the image of the young, that's a good shot.
That's on Olympic Boulevard, underneath the overpass.
By the big hotels?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, the Lyndon Johnson was appearing at the Century Plaza Hotel, big fundraiser, and a giant battle, and the police went crazy. Oh, this, you can't see the baby here, but this, the baby, who's now a 40-year-old man, is making this documentary.
So there is, I think there's another shot with
there,
him.
There he is.
The yeah. Show. And so did things get pretty brutal with the cops? There was a moment where...
Oh, yeah. There were hundreds of people who were, had head lacerations and bruises. That one key picture does not appear in this, but it obviously exists someplace. Like, people came to me and I photographed. This is someone who I think was a police agent, who was mingling in the crowd.
Oh, really?
Every so often you saw somebody. You felt who just didn't really fit, their story wasn't right. And I think that was one of them who just got too close and he had to take his chances.
And he came to you afterwards?
I was the person that a lot of the injured people came to get documented, to photograph their bruises and their injuries.
And were there any ramifications ever in terms of people coming back to you and knowing that you know, the cops or FBI or anybody? Or
there are a lot of, I mean, I still have bonds with some of the people who I photographed because they were like 20 years younger than
me. Wait,
I.
You still have what?
Bonds with them, like they know my name and I know where they're doing, what they're doing.
No, but I mean, did the police ever come back to you and harass you because they knew?
Yes. I mean, police agents would come, they'd show up. Our phones were tapped. Our license plates were recorded wherever we went, every meeting. We got our Freedom of Information documents for a while, and we were like under a lot of surveillance. And we had a lot of people who simply were police agents who pretended to be friends. And there was a lot of harassment. Not just the police, the FBI would send anonymous letters to people. Like Barbara's parents got letters from well-wishers, do you know what your daughter is doing? Things to create family emotional ramifications and things like that, yes.
Did you ever...
And not too many years ago, maybe 10 years ago, we found out that our phone records were being obtained by the Justice Department. And we have no idea what that was all about. Apparently, the phone company, after a certain length of time, have to let you know, in many cases, that your phone records are being taken by the government. Probably not anymore. No, probably, you never get told, you know, considering what's going on now.
Right. And did you ever, at a certain point, request to see if there were files under your name?
Oh, yeah. We have hundreds and hundreds of pages.
Is that material here?
No, I think I still have that. You might want it.
Well, I'm sure people...
Or copies of it.
Yeah, I'm sure
people... Like on the big demonstration, again, anti-war demonstration in 1967 at the Pentagon, the FBI in Los Angeles sent a telegram to the FBI in Washington, D.C. that Charles Brittin and Barbara Brittin are flying to Washington for this demonstration on some private airline. It was different than they, that we were going. We went to the demonstration and they went to Expo 67 in Montreal with friends. I mean,
you and probably 200,000 other people.
Strange.
So was this Century City demonstration, was this a particularly important one for any reason? Or?
It turned out to be important because it was the biggest demonstration in Los Angeles against the Vietnam War, and it created this night of terror. There were like 1,500 police, 15,000 demonstrators, a lot of them from the West Side. Families, women brought their children, and the police just went crazy. At a certain point, they ordered you to disperse. And when you don't, and you can't disperse very fast.
Well, because when there's so many people.
And like for example, these two pictures, there's this one person sitting down blocking an Olympic Boulevard. He sits down by himself, a whole row of police. then dozen or more kids sit down, and they were all young people, and this is how the police dealt with them. Just beat them mercilessly. And some of them sat down holding flowers, if you can believe it.
Well, it's a, yeah, and a peaceful gesture.
And then, and there are ways of moving crowds of people like that. You pick them up and carry them away. But it's much more fun to close them.
Are there any shots there of the group at large?
No, I don't. We're not in this group, no. I didn't think, I was in close. You can see what I was doing, I was staying close to the people. I wasn't doing panoramic shots or anything. I was staying in as close as I could to this mass of people. A little boy on his father's shoulders, and suddenly the police, they disperse. And you don't disperse fast enough, they start hitting you. It was a mess. But it created a consciousness on a lot of West Side people that, how dangerous life could be.
Right, who previously been kind of unnerved from all of that. Okay. All right, we can put a little stop for a second. Where and what your involvement was, and
well, my first knowledge about them was reading a newspaper story about their first demonstrations in the Bay Area, and they just looked sort of scary to me. I mean, they went on to Sacramento and carrying shotguns, which I still can't really believe is legal. But I guess it's not hidden weapons or anything, and they didn't have shells in their guns. To make a point about the need of some control over police violence in the black community. And that was so far from anything Barbara and I had been involved in. We had seen people with guns in the South, and we knew there were a lot of guns in the black community, but we'd never seen anyone publicly display them as boldly. And it got an enormous amount of publicity. And probably within a year or two, maybe 6 or 8 months, we realized that there were organizers starting a Black Panther Party in Los Angeles. And all of a sudden it was very widespread. Practically all young people, practically all related to community service, things to do for the living conditions of people in the ghetto, and mostly for children, and also to organize for protection against the police. And the first thing, there was something called the Community Alert Patrols, which were, and I did posters for them, which was basically these roving people carrying cameras and tape recordings, just to be around when things happened. And that created a lot of publicity, and I went on a number of those drives, and I never saw anything. I got no photographs of that. But I suddenly realized that there was a lot of other activity going on, and immediately the Panthers were subject to a lot of police violence.
Must have been so provocative to be armed and militant.
And also, no one was saying, we're going to overthrow the government right now, but there was a lot of language which says, you know, we're going to build a black organized military power so that we can protect our ghettos, like ourselves. Like, there was like a language that would lead you to suggest that they might secede, because the only way to protect yourself from the white community was to like set up your perimeters and don't allow the police in. So there was a lot of inflammatory material, and there also was a lot of provocative material by the police themselves, so there would not be a unified black movement. But that had been going on during the Civil Rights Movement, when J. Edgar Hoover wanted so much to damage the reputation of Martin Luther King, all the campaign against him that went on. So the same thing was going on with the Panthers. And it sort of in Los Angeles culminated with the assassination of the top two Panther leaders here in Los Angeles on the UCLA campus.
He just went over.
Yes.
We just talked about.
And when I basically photographed their community programs. They had literacy programs, they had the breakfast for children, they had medical clinics, a lot of sympathizing white medical people, students and doctors, to do give medical facilities that were available to the black community. And I just photographed as much of that material as I could. I just photographed the people. Most of the pictures are not dramatic. They're just documentation of their community programs.
And was that mostly in the Los Angeles area?
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I went to a few big events in San Francisco because there would be kind of unity meet. Because at that point, there were Panther organizations all over the United States. And people were being killed. In Chicago, the police killed the top leaders there. They broke in and just killed them into their house. And then there were a couple of things on the East Coast also, where Panthers were assassinated. And sometimes it was passed off, and sometimes it's probably true, that it was competition between competing personalities. Because the Panthers did recruit a lot of street people. There were a lot of people who were close to crime. And so it was dangerous. And of course there were a lot of police agents informing, infiltrating, creating problems. But my photograph basically, when I look at them, there were Panther demonstrations, but what did I photograph?
So were you almost like, would you say you were like the house photographer for Black Panthers West?
In Los Angeles.
Yeah.
There was another photographer who was a police agent. And we talked about cameras together. But he insisted on getting the Panther leadership. He said, you all need to be well identified. So he had them sit down, and he'd do, I've heard of passport photograph, which is basically setting up files for the police and getting vital statistics.
Right, the top 10 most
and
wanted.
And later came out that he was either a police or just a police agent.
And were you conflicted at all about the Black Panthers' approaches occasionally? Or
I was afraid. I was afraid because there were guns around. And I was afraid when I was with Panthers that, you know, if there was an attack on I'd be at risk. But one thing, here, the photograph, one of the political education classes was in a ghetto park. There's a child copying down a slogan of Mao. People of the world unite and defeat the U.S. aggressors. Well, that's kind of sweet and
it's
weird.
Good
and, and weird, yeah. And then, of course,
there were some images I had.
And, like, you know, here's a place in a Los Angeles park. And that, like, here is a woman teaching a children's class.
Right, this is a community class, and she has a recorder there.
Mm-hmm, right. And there are, you know, women in the background. And then the children, and here is like a free child care, classes in phonics, math, history, and health, free lunch and snacks. There's a Panther school in Central Avenue.
That's such a quintessential look, too, their fashion and their...
Oh, yes, they're streetwise.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Is this somebody you've known at all?
He was a local leader. This is somebody who knows. This is Geronimo Pratt, who was in prison for 20 years, convicted of a murder. He was a Vietnam veteran who came back, and he became the local leader of security in Los Angeles. And he was framed on this murder charge, and he was 20 years in prison before they reversed his case. And it's like a legal meeting over or something.
Come on in, Julian. You can slip right in. We're in the Black Panther. We've moved on to the Black Panther.
Yes, I was.
Go back to where you were.
No, you can carry on. Why is it too depressing, the Black Panthers?
No, but
I'm talking about how scary it was.
Yeah, just how intense and the stakes were so high.
And at that point, Barbara and I armed ourselves because we started getting threats. And some people had gasoline poured through their mailbox slots and lit.
So at that point, you actually, mm-hmm. you got a gun and Were you conflicted about that, or was it just something?
No, I had no principal things against self-defense. I mean, as a child, you know, hunting with my father, and we murdered innocent rabbits.
That's an incredible shot, though. I mean, these guys on their porch,
yeah,
just looking like, just ready for anything.
Yeah.
And they look like completely menacing and completely innocent at the same time.
Now, Barbara took a gun safety course at the Culver City Police Department. And she got highlighted on that. We found in our dossiers that she finally got from the FBI. That was the key thing that made her number one on roundup, pickup for the national emergency, to go into our concentration camps. You know, the camps are all out there, being maintained, to take up to like immediately 20,000 people. And Barbara, when we got our dossiers, she was number one,
yeah,
in the first roundup group. And basically, we determined from our lawyer and someone who knows about it, that it was because she had gone to the Culver City Police Department and got a gun safety course, and it recommended that other people, if they were going to have guns, they go to the police and have a gun safety course.
Yeah, so they
and I was on the third level pickup, because all I had was a camera.
Yeah. So, I mean, you may have talked about this before, but, you know, how did you resolve that, you know, that significant shift from beginning out, you know, sort of be participating and actually leading violent classes and then going
to
the gun instruction?
Spiritually or philosophically committed to nonviolence. It was nice and it was uplifting, but it wasn't a religious commitment.
Yeah.
We were materialists. And I think the harder thing was just to live with the fear.
Mm-hmm.
This is the Panther office after the police raided it.
In Los Angeles.
And it was, we just knew that there were people being killed, mm-hmm, and people being framed and betrayed. The hardest thing was to live the fact that it was scary.
And you felt the gun was going to make you safer somehow?
Well, we knew, yes. Because we knew there were, all the people who hated us were not all smart assassins. They were going to be dumb, crazy people.
Mm-hmm.
And yes, having a weapon at home was comforting.
Mm-hmm.
Did you ever have to use it?
No.
Now, did you look at the Bunchy Carter funeral pictures?
We did.
Okay, great.
Yeah. Moved on.
Terrific. Okay.
Do you want to pick out some of the things that you wanted to go?
Yeah, I really was interested in, you know, what you were talking about earlier on, Charles, about your activism in Los Angeles, you know, versus your activism in the South, and so. These pictures relate to the demonstrations, I understand, at the federal building, mm-hmm, in support of what was happening in Selma.
Okay.
And I assume that was the main event being the attack on the Pettus Bridge. Is that correct? Is that the main? Was that the main event?
I think that came later.
Well, that was 65.
I think around Selma, there have been weeks, if not months, of demonstrations, and I can't historically remember exactly what the sequence was, but it had been going on for weeks at least, and there had been repeated calls by all the organizations that were involved, like for the federal government to intervene, mm-hmm, as to what was happening in Selma, that, mm-hmm, there needed to be federal intervention to stop.
And hence, the side of the federal building is a place to make
those
demonstrations.
And there were weeks of demonstrations here, mm-hmm, at the federal building.
Yeah.
And mainly, it was a whole new group of demonstrators, because the emotion had spread widely. These were mostly college kids who had been maybe at some demonstrations, but they weren't the people that you were used to seeing. And there were many hundreds of them, and so the demonstrations were relatively large. And they moved to a new location, which was the federal building, mm-hmm, downtown Los Angeles. And they blocked the doors, they blocked the driveways, hundreds of them sitting down all together.
can you sort of, beyond what you just said, can you characterize those relative to the demonstrations and the marches that you experienced in the southern states? I mean, how might they have been different?
They felt very innocent because none of these people had ever had anything happen to them. And it was in downtown Los Angeles, which seems relatively civilized. And until the police power manifests itself, you can't believe anything like this can happen. Mm-hmm. And just all of a sudden, violence breaks out, and civilized people, men in suits with shined shoes and neckties on, are suddenly clubbing and beating and dragging people. It's like a weird something, like a disease. There's a transformation. These civilized people become monsters all of a sudden. Yeah. And basically, these were really innocent 18, 19, 20 year old young people, mm-hmm. who had just seen things on television. They didn't know it could happen to them in bright California sunshine with all the press there, mm-hmm. with everybody watching. It wasn't at night. Mm-hmm. There was nothing subtle about it. The federal government, probably the federal marshals in Los Angeles were given the order, clear the space, because the federal government cannot be impacted this way. And so they then expressed how they felt.
Mm-hmm. Now, these pictures, to my understanding, are dated 1966. But are you sure that they were made after the Watts riots? Is that correct? Or
they
were. Okay. Yes. So.
And whenever the Selma demonstration would be, I can't give any dates. But like this. This is sort of an example. This man.
Yeah.
He's got beautiful, nice, sleek necktie.
Yeah.
He's wearing a suit.
Yes.
And he's grabbing this woman's leg.
Yeah, who's also well-dressed as well.
And she's very old. Look at those legs.
Yeah.
This is a favorite of a lot of people, for a lot of different reasons.
So, I mean, is he involved with the federal government, do you think?
He's a federal marshal.
Federal marshal.
He's a federal marshal.
Yeah.
So, should we do tape change? You're running out?
Yeah.
So, why don't we're going to do a tape change,
okay.
And we can reconvene and pull our next round.
Okay. Julian?
Yes.
There was a little printed thing about the police arresting people around the funeral site.